there are a few things that are remaining in the discussion of the series, and those we shall complete today. Okay. We discussed for a long time the series of non-negative terms, and only in the last class we discussed the series of the terms which may have positive and negative signs, and we discussed what is known as Abel's test. Okay. A series which is convergent but which is not absolutely convergent, it has a special name. It is called conditionally convergent. Okay. Okay. That is, to give a more formal definition, suppose you have a series sigma a n, n going from 1 to infinity. This is said to be conditionally convergent. Conditionally convergent, or we say it converges conditionally. Okay. If the series converges, that is, if sigma a n converges, but it is not absolutely convergent. Okay, that means, and sigma mod a n diverges. We have seen an example of a series of this kind. Okay, for example, we saw this series yesterday: 1 minus half plus 1 by 3 minus 1 by 4, etc. Okay, we have seen that this series converges, but it is not an absolutely convergent series. So this is an example of a conditionally convergent series. Okay. Now, in case of this conditional and absolute convergence, there appears one very important question, and that is what we shall also discuss today, and that is what is called rearrangement. Okay. Okay. Now, to just motivate this, after all, series is something like an infinite sum. Okay. Now, if we take a, let us say, a finite sum, suppose we take say something like a1 plus a2 plus a3 plus a4 plus a5, etc. Okay. Since the addition is commutative as well as associative, it does not matter in what way I take the sum, whether I add a1 to a2, then add to a3, or I take a5 here or a3 there, it does not matter. Okay. Whichever way you write this, the sum is going to be the same. Okay. Right. But that may or may not happen in case of the infinite series. Okay. Right. So, now, actually, what is meant by rearrangement? It is that you write these terms of the series in some different order. Okay. That is called a rearrangement. Okay. Or to make it more precise, suppose we take a map tau from n to n. Suppose it's a bisection. Okay. It's 1, 1, and 2. As you know, such maps are also called permutation. Okay. If it is a finite set, you call a 1, 1, and 1, 2 map as a permutation. Okay. Right. So, if you consider a series sigma a suffix tau n, that is, suppose your given series is sigma a n, instead of that you consider sigma a suffix tau n, then this is called rearrangement of sigma a n. Sigma a n. Okay. That means basically what the term says, that rearrangement, that you just rearrange the terms of the series, write the terms in some different order. Okay. Right. Now, what is the obvious question here? If the original series converges, does this rearrangement also converge? Okay. And does it converge to the same sum? Okay. If it converges, does it converge to the same sum? Okay. Now, it so turns out that that is true if the series is absolutely convergent. Okay. And the things are very bad if the series is conditionally convergent. We can just see an example here. Okay, let us take this same example. We have seen that this series is 1 minus etc. We have seen that this is a convergent series. Okay. Suppose its sum is S. Okay. Suppose its sum is S. Okay. Right. Now let us just rewrite the series in some different order. Okay. What I will do now is that I will write the series as follows. Okay. So 1 minus half minus 1 by 4, okay. Instead of taking 1 by 3, I take the next term as 1 by 4, okay. Then I will take plus 1 by 3, then I will take the next two negative term, 1 minus 6, minus, what is the, so 1 minus 4, the next negative term will be minus 1 by 8, okay, right. Then take the next positive term, that is 1 by 5, and then minus 1 by 10, minus 1 by 12, etc. Okay. I suppose you know, the original series was, there was one positive term, one negative term, etc., followed by that. Okay. Now what I am doing is, I am taking the same series, I am taking the first positive term, then the next two negative terms, then the next positive term, again followed by next two negative terms, and do like that. Okay. Alright. So it's a, so this is a rearrangement of this same series. This is a rearrangement of this same series. Okay. So all right. Now let us see a few things here. For example, this 1 minus half is half. Okay. 1 minus half is half. So this is 1 by 2 minus 1 by 4 plus again this 1 by 3 minus 1 by 6. You can say this same as 1 by 6. Okay. It is same as 1. So the next will be 1 by 6 minus 1 by 8. Then similarly you can say that 1 by 5 minus 1 by 10, again 1 by 10, so that is, so the next two terms will be 1 by 10 minus 1 by 12, etc. Okay. This will be the series after simplification. Okay. Right. You can see that I can, this half is a common factor from all of them. Okay. Okay. So suppose we take that common factor out, what remains? Half into 1 minus, this will be 1 by 2, that will be plus 1 by 3. Then minus 1 by 4, etc., plus 1 by 5, minus 1 by 6, etc., etc. Okay. All right. Do you see that it is the same series here? Okay. So now what is its sum? It is half s. Okay. It is 1 by 2 s. Okay. Right. So it is the rearrangement of the same series, but it converges to a different number. Okay. It converges to a different number. Okay. So this idea of this example is to show that if the conditional convergence behaves very badly with respect to rearrangements. Okay. And in fact what is known is something much worse. Okay. Not only that rearrangements will converge to a different number, in fact given any real number we can find some rearrangement of the series such that that rearrangement converges to that given real number. Not only that, we can also find a rearrangement so that the new series with that rearrangement diverges. Okay. And on the other hand, if the series converges absolutely, then all its rearrangements converge. Okay, and all those rearrangements converge to the same sum. Okay. So let us just write this as a theorem. Okay. Okay. So if sigma a n converges absolutely, then all its rearrangements converge, all its rearrangements converge and converge to the same sum, to the same sum. Okay. On the other hand, if sigma a n converges conditionally, then given any real number we can find a rearrangement such that that rearrangement converges to that real one. Then so what I would say that for every s in R, for every s in R, there exists a rearrangement sigma, I will call it rearrangement sigma a suffix tau n converging to s. Okay, converging to s. Okay. Also, we can find a rearrangement so that rearrangement diverges. Okay, so we can say that also there exists a rearrangement sigma a tau n that diverges. Okay, so that is the importance of absolute convergence. Okay, if you know that the series is absolutely convergent, or if the series is of non-negative terms. Okay, remember this: if the series is of non-negative terms, there is no difference between convergence and absolute convergence. So in that case, you can rearrange the terms of the series in any manner you like, and that will not change the convergence or divergence, or it will not also change the sum. Okay, whereas in case of conditional convergence, things are quite bad. All right. Now there are a few elementary properties of the series which perhaps we should have discussed immediately after discussing the series, and those are as follows. Suppose we take two series, sigma a n, n going from 1 to infinity, and let us say sigma b n, n going from 1 to infinity. Suppose both of them converge. Okay, suppose both of them converge, then we can say that if you take the series sigma a n plus b n, okay, that should also converge. Okay, and sum should be same as the sum of sigma a n and sigma b n. Okay, so let us just see that if sigma a n and sigma b n converge, then sigma a n plus b n also converges, and sigma a n plus b n, n going from 1 to infinity, this is same as sigma a n plus sigma b n equal to. By the way, you may wonder, we are not going to discuss the proof of this theorem here, because that proof is somewhat lengthy. Those of you who are interested in the proof, you can see the proof in Rudin's book. Okay? It is, this theorem is given in Rudin. Okay? Okay, coming back to this, so what it says is that if the two series converge, their sum also converge, and similarly if you multiply the series by some real number lambda, then the new series will also converge. That is, also we can say that also sigma lambda a n, this is also a convergent series. Okay, and its sum will be same as lambda times sigma a n going from 1 to infinity. Okay, all right, and this will follow simply by taking the partial sums. Okay, suppose s n is a partial sum of the series. Suppose s n is a 1 plus a 2 plus a n, and t n is say b 1 plus b 2 plus b n, then saying that sigma a n converges is same as saying that s n converges. Okay, s n converges to s, and t n converges, let us say t. Okay, then use the corresponding theorem about the sequences, then s n plus t n converges to s plus t. Okay, and similarly lambda s n converges to lambda times s. That is all in there is the proof. Okay, I said already that whatever we want to say or prove about the series, everything can be done using the sequence of partial sums. Okay, and using the corresponding theorem about the sequences. Okay, but what you will also notice further is that we cannot give a similar characterization if we take the product. Okay, for example, if we take this series, okay, let me again recall that is, suppose we take this Sn as the sum sigma, let us say sigma aj, j going from 1 to n, and say tn as sigma bj, j going from 1 to n, then partial sum of the series sigma aj an plus bn, that is same as sn plus tn, that is fine. Okay, but suppose I take this series sigma an bn, okay, n going from 1 to infinity, okay. And then the partial sum of this will be a1 b1 plus a2 b2 plus an bn, and that is not the product of Sn and Tn, right. That is not a product of Sn and Tn. So we cannot say that if Sn converges and Tn converges, this series also converges. So in general, we cannot say that if the two series converges, that is, if the sigma an and sigma bn, if both of them converge, we cannot infer from that that sigma an bn is also a convergent series. Okay. So to consider the products, okay, there is totally different notion, what is called Cauchy products. And Cauchy product is something like this, okay. For example, the first term, suppose I denote the terms of the product as sigma cn, okay. Okay, I denote the terms of the product as sigma cn, I think going from 1 to infinity, okay. Then this first term, okay, let, I think for this, for considering this, it is convenient to start with 0 to it, take both the series starting from 0 to infinity, okay. That is sigma an also going from 0 to infinity and sigma bn also going from 0 to infinity, just a minor convenience here, okay. And so sigma cn will also I will take from 0 to infinity, okay. So the first number here is c0, the first number here is c0, so that is taken as a0 b0, that is just the product of the corresponding terms, okay. Then the next number c1, okay, that is taken as a1 b0 plus a0 b1, okay, a1 b0 plus a0 b1, okay, right. And now you can understand how we will proceed, okay. For example, next number c2, that will be taken as a2 b0 plus a1 b1 plus a0 b2. That is what we are doing here, we are taking all those indices such that the sum becomes 2 here, okay. So now you can understand how the general term will be. So in general, the term cn, that will be sigma ak bn minus k, k going from 0 to n, okay. So suppose you form a series like this, okay, then that series is called the Cauchy product of these two series, sigma an and sigma bn, okay. And we can say something about the Cauchy product, if sigma an and sigma bn converges, then whether Cauchy product also converges or not, there are some conditions for that, okay. But since that is not very important right now for us, we shall not go into theorems of those kind, okay. For the time being, all that you should remember is that convergence of these two series, sigma an and sigma bn, certainly does not imply that sigma an bn converges, okay, right. And of course, directly it also does not imply that sigma cn converges, you need some additional conditions for that, okay. Alright, now I think for the time being we shall close the discussion of the series and let us move on to next topic. But to move on to the next topic, okay, let us start something with which depends on the series, okay. I shall define a new set, okay. Let us say I will call that set L1, L superscript 1, okay. This is a, let us say this is a set of real sequences, okay. And real sec, as you know, a sequence is nothing but a real sequence is nothing but a function from n to r, okay. So suppose I denote any such function as x from n to r, okay, then image of any number n here, by using this notation I should denote by x of n, right, okay. But in a sequence it is customary to denote it as x suffix n. We can continue to use this notation, so I will just say that x means this sequence xn, okay. X means the function from n going to r, and that is nothing but say by the sequence xn. Now this notation is sometimes more convenient when you also want to talk about sequence of sequences, okay. Then for example, suppose I want to talk of sequence of these sequences, then you will need some more either superscript or something. So instead of that, for that this notation is more convenient, okay. All right. So what I want to do is that I shall take the set of all sequences X. Okay, so X is a sequence such that sigma xn is absolutely convergent. That is, if you take the series sigma xn, either you write xn or this way, okay, whichever way you want, like, okay, sigma xn is absolutely convergent. Okay. All right. Okay. That means what? Sigma mod xn is convergent. Okay. That is sigma mod xn is convergent. Okay. For example, if you look at this theorem here, can I say that if sigma n and sigma bn, if both are absolutely convergent, will it follow that sigma an plus bn is also absolutely convergent? Right? Because if you take mod an plus bn, that is less than or equal to mod an plus mod bn. Okay, and since sigma mod an and sigma mod bn, those are convergence. So what you can say that sigma mod an plus mod bn, that's a convergent series. And then use comparison test, okay, right? So that is trivial. Okay, so if there are two series which are absolutely convergent, then their sum is also absolutely convergent. Okay. In other words, if I use this notation, I can say that if x and y belong to L1, then x plus y also belongs to L1. And next is, I will say that if x belongs to L1 and let us say some alpha belongs to R, then alpha x also belongs to L1. Okay, right? Because the series alpha xn will be nothing but mod alpha times mod xn. Okay, that is also a convergent series. Okay, right? So what it means is that if you take this set L1, okay, then if you take any two elements in this set, their sum is also in this set, and product of a real number and any element in this is also in this set. In other words, this set has these two operations, okay, addition of two elements and multiplication of a scalar and a element in this, okay, right? Scalar is real number, okay. So what is the obvious thing to do next, okay, right? You are also learning linear algebra simultaneously, right? So you all heard of vector spaces, right? So vector space is a structure which has these two operations. Okay, so what is the next obvious question that we should ask? That whether this is a vector space. Okay, whether this is a vector space. Okay, and what is the answer? Right, because see, after all, what is the operation here? If you take two, anyway, it's a sum of two functions. Okay, operation. So we can say operation is coordinate wise. Okay, x plus y, nth entry of x plus y is xn plus yn. Right. Okay. And so what is the zero element? Constant sequence zero, right? Okay. And so it is this operation of x plus y, it is associative, commutative, okay, and simple. Also, you can also verify all other axioms that alpha times x plus y is alpha x plus alpha, etc. Okay. All right. So I will simply say that L1 is a vector space. Okay. Well, that's nothing great, but there is something more about this. Okay. Now, because this I could have said even if I did not use this word absolutely convergent. Okay, suppose I had taken the sequences only of convergent sequences, still I could have done this. Okay, I could have converted that into a vector space. Okay, that's also done. Okay, now I shall make use of this fact. Okay, because of this fact, what I know is that the series sigma mod xn is a convergent series. Okay. So what I will do is that I shall give some notation for that sum. I shall call it norm of x. Okay, this is usually, it is called norm of x. Okay, norm of x. Okay, norm of x, it is nothing but sigma n going from 1 to infinity mod x. Okay, we know that once x is in L1, okay, once x is in L1, this is a real number, that it is absolutely convergent. So this is defined. Okay, So norm of x is defined. Okay. So norm now it means it's a function from L1 to R. Okay. It's a function from L1 to R. Right. Now let us ask some very obvious questions. What properties does this function have? Okay. Is this clear? So we have a function norm which goes from L1 to R, right? Of course, we are using the notation in a slightly different manner. Okay? Since if norm is a function from L1 to R, actually denoted norm of x by this, right? Something like f of x, okay? Right? But anyway, this is customary to denote, bring this x here. Okay, bring that x here. All right. What are the properties? Let me just say first property. For example, can you say that this norm of x is bigger than or equal to 0 for all x in L1? Okay, norm of x is bigger than or equal to 0 for all x in L1. Okay, all right. Okay. And what is the norm of the 0 element? 0. Okay, all right. And suppose norm of some element is 0, then what can you say? If sigma mod xn is 0, then all of these xn's must be 0. Okay. So can we say this, that norm of x is equal to 0 if and only if x is equal to 0? Okay. Norm of x equal to 0 if and only if x is equal to 0. Okay. All right. Okay. Second property. Okay. I want to say something about norm of x plus y. Norm of x, suppose you take two elements x and y in L1. I want to know how is norm of x plus y related to norm x and norm y, okay, right, okay, and that is something we saw just now, okay, right. We can say that, for example, what we are asking is this, what is the relationship between norm of x plus y is nothing but sigma mod xn plus yn, right, that is norm of x plus y, okay, and what is norm x, it is sigma mod xn, and what is norm y, it is sigma mod yn, okay. Now how are these three numbers related? It is clear, okay, because mod of xn plus yn is less than or equal to mod xn, so this is less than or equal to this, right, okay, right. So we can say that this is less than or equal to norm of x plus norm of y for all x and y in L1, okay, okay. And lastly, I want to say that norm of alpha times x, norm of alpha, that is alpha, suppose alpha is a near real number, norm of alpha times x should be sigma mod alpha xn, okay. Is it clear that this should be same as mod alpha times norm x? Okay, mod alpha times norm x. This should be true for every x in L1 and alpha in R. Okay, alpha in R. Okay, right. Okay. Okay. Now, what can you say about these three properties? Have you seen something similar earlier? It is, these are properties very similar to the absolute value function on the real line. Okay, on real line we define the function modulus of a real number, and when we listed the properties of that function, those properties were very similar. Okay, right. All these, for example, suppose x were a real number, all these things are true. Okay, if x and y are real number, so this is a function which basically has the properties which very similar to the properties what is called absolute value of real number. Okay, now. Such functions can be defined on several vector spaces. Okay. And when it can be done, that function is called a norm, and a corresponding vector space is called a normed vector space or normed linear space. Okay. So let us just make a formal definition as follows. That is, suppose V is a real vector space. Suppose V is a real vector space. And a function, let us say norm, going from V to R is called a norm. Is called a norm on V. If it satisfies these three properties, okay. If it satisfies these three properties, okay. All right. If you want, we'll write once again. If first is norm of X is bigger than or equal to 0 for every X in V, and norm of X is equal to 0 if and only if X is equal to 0. Okay. All right. And the second property is norm of X plus Y is less than or equal to norm of X plus norm of Y for every X, Y in V. And third property is norm of alpha times X is same as mod alpha times norm of X for every X in V and alpha in R. Okay. Right. Okay. And what I said last is that a norm linear space is an ordered pair, okay, is a pair V norm, okay, is a pair V norm. So this is a term that we are called norm linear space, or we can also call norm vector space, okay, where V is a vector space and this is a norm on V, okay. So is a pair where V is a vector space and norm is a norm on V. And why we say that, why we talk in terms of these pairs? So it is possible that on the same vector space there may exist several functions satisfying this, okay, right. On the same vector space you may be able to define different, we'll see examples of this kind of thing little later, okay. So as a vector space those two objects will be same, but as norm linear spaces those two objects will be different, okay. So V with some, let us say norm 1 and V with norm 2, as vector spaces those are the same, but as norm linear spaces those are different. So that is why we usually talk about the pair, okay. Of course again, as is the practice, when it is clear from the discussion what is the norm that you are talking about, then we will simply say V is a norm linear space, okay. Also there is one obvious question here, why we are taking real vector space, okay. What can we not take vector space on some other field, okay. Of course we can also take vector space on complex numbers. You can take complex vector space, then see, as far as this first two are concerned, there is, it has no reference to the scalar, okay. Only this last axiom that refers to the scalars, okay, and that will change, okay. This will become for every X in V and alpha in C, okay, every X in V and alpha in C, okay. That will be called complex vector space, and so corresponding it will be a complex norm linear space, and this is what we can call real norm linear space. Since there is not much difference as far as the definition is concerned, we shall not bother too much about this, okay. Now this is an example of a real vector space, okay. Now instead of taking the sequences from N to R, suppose I had taken sequences from N to C, then also you can define absolute convergence and all that in the usual way, okay. That would become an example of a complex vector space, okay. Now the next question, why exactly we are discussing all these things and what is the idea of discussing this norm linear spaces, okay. To understand that, let us again look at our definition of the convergence of a sequence, okay. How did we define the convergence of a sequence? Suppose Xn is a sequence in R, okay. Suppose we take a sequence in R. Sequence in R, okay. Then when did we say Xn converges to X, okay? We say that Xn converges to X. Xn converges to X. If you remember what we said, that this meant that for every epsilon bigger than 0, there exists n 0 in n, there exists n 0 in n such that n bigger than or equal to, that is if n is bigger than or equal to n 0, n bigger, n 0 implies mod xn minus x less than epsilon, okay, mod xn minus x less than epsilon, okay. In other words, the concept of convergence of a sequence depends on this function mod xn minus x, okay. And we proved several theorems about the convergent sequences about the real numbers using these properties of this absolute value function, and of course some theorems using the order completeness of the real numbers, etc., okay. But you can say that a sequence can be defined on any set, okay. Okay, after all, what is a sequence? Sequence is a function whose domain is the set of all natural numbers. Codomain can be anything, okay. So instead of considering sequence of real numbers, I can consider a sequence of any objects, okay, right, sequence of say elements in R2 or Rn, sequence of vectors, sequence of matrices, okay, sequence of functions, okay. And suppose I want to ask the question, how do we define what is meant by such a sequence converges? Suppose you are given a sequence of matrices, okay, okay, and suppose that sequence is An, okay, each An is a matrix of some fixed order, let us say 3 by 3, okay, and I want to say that this sequence An converges to A, okay. What is the meaning of that, or how does one define? We can say that if we had some notations like this, norm on that, then I could have simply imitated this, okay. This will simply change to norm of xn minus x, okay. So instead of sequences in a real line, sequences in a real line, I can take sequence in any non-linear space, okay. I can take sequence in any non-linear space and define what is meant by the sequence converges in that non-linear space, okay, right. Or more generally, okay, this is one idea, okay, that is the reason for discussing non-linear spaces, okay. More generally, see, by mod xn minus x is nothing but a distance between these two numbers x and xn, okay, distance between two numbers x and xn. And so if you remember what we had said all the time, saying that sequence converges means distance between and xn and x becomes small as n becomes large, that was the idea, okay. So one can say similarly that if we have a concept of distance in any set, okay, suppose we have a concept of distance, then we can talk about the convergence of a sequence in that set, okay. All that we need is a concept of a distance, okay. Similarly, for example, other concept of limits, continuity, etc., all those concepts depend in some sense either on this like absolute value function or on the concept of distance, okay. So we can also develop all those concepts in more general sets like that, okay. What is the advantage? See, now we have proved, let us say, some theorems about convergent sequences, okay. For example, we have proved that every convergent sequence is Cauchy or every convergent sequence is bounded. We proved all these things for the sequences of real numbers. Let us say sometime later we talk of sequences in R2 or R3 or Rn, or sequences of matrices or sequences of functions, then again we can define what is meant by convergent there, and again we may have to again separately prove that every convergent sequence is Cauchy or every convergent sequence is bounded and things like that, okay. That means essentially we will be repeating the same proof again in various different contexts, okay. What is the way to avoid that, okay? Instead of avoid this repetition, that method is what is called abstraction, okay, and it's very very commonly used in mathematics, okay. You may have heard this word, that mathematics is a very abstract subject, okay, and people use it in some sort of a negative way, that mathematics is an abstract subject. But abstraction is a very powerful tool, it's used in all sciences, and as I said, because of this abstraction we can avoid these repetitions, okay. It saves lot of time and energy, and it is more efficient way of doing this. So what we will do is that we see, for example, what we have done here, this norm linear space is an abstraction, okay, okay, abstraction of what, a real line and then that L1 and so many spaces, okay, whatever common to all those spaces, those properties we have taken and defined that as a norm linear space, okay. So similarly we will do about the distance, okay, similarly we will do about the distance, and then follow the idea, then after that we shall just develop all the theory in those particular, either in the non-linear spaces or those new objects, okay. By the way, let me just tell what those new objects are called. Those are called metric spaces, okay. Those are called metric spaces, okay, right. And then we shall develop all this theory in metric spaces. Okay, and once we develop in metric spaces, it will be applied to, it can be applied to any different any of these other specific examples. Okay, R, R2, Rn, L1, and all those things. Okay. Okay. Now let us come to this. What is a metric space or what is a metric? This is something more general than nonlinear spaces. Okay. Here, what we have seen, we shall subsequently show that every nonlinear space is also a metric space. Okay. But before that, which is basically same as saying that metric space is a more general concept, because norm is defined only on a vector space. Okay. The starting point has to be a vector space, whereas metric can be defined on any set. Okay. So we take X as any non-empty set. Okay. X as any non-empty set. Okay. Then what is a metric? It is nothing but a function which says something. Suppose you take two points X and Y in Y, it says what is the distance between those two points. Okay. So that function which satisfies the properties which we normally associate with the distance between the two functions, distance between the two points, whatever we commonly associate, some of those properties are taken, and those are taken as a definition of a distance or definition of a metric. Okay. So obviously we talk about the distance between the two points, so it means it is a function from the pair of points. It will associate some real number to a pair of points. Okay. So we will say that a function d from x cross x to r. Okay. Function d from x cross x to r is called a metric. Is called a metric if it satisfies some properties. If it satisfies some properties, what are those properties? Those properties are again very similar to this. Okay, first property is that suppose you take two points, and if you take distance between, it's called a metric, and metric is same as distance. This is just a different word used. Okay, so dxy, that is, this is distance between two. In fact, strictly speaking, I should write one more bracket here. Okay, because it is d of this some element in x cross x. That element is x comma y. So strictly speaking, I should use this notation. Okay, but okay, I mean, just we'll understand what we mean is this. Okay, so d, this is okay. Let me just remove this. Okay, just for the convenience. So dxy, this is bigger than or equal to 0 for every xy in x. Okay, that is what we normally expect. The distance between any two points should be a non-negative number, and it should be 0 only when, or if x and x, distance between x and the points, should be 0, and if the distance between the two points are 0, those two points must coincide. Okay, so which is same as saying this, and dxy is equal to 0 if and only if x is equal to y. Okay. Okay. Then second property is that distance between x and y, this should be same as distance between y and x. Okay. It should not matter whether I call distance from x to y or from y to x, that should be the same. Okay, this should be true for every x y in x. Okay, and lastly, okay, by the way, this property has a name. In fact, it's an obvious name. This is called symmetry. Okay, this is called symmetry. So we express this by saying the distance is a symmetric function. Okay, this property is called symmetry. Okay. Then last property, suppose we take three points x, y and z. Okay, then we want to compare the distance between x and z and distance between x and y and distance between y and z. Okay, suppose we take three points. Okay, you imagine that those three points form a triangle. Okay, then distance between x and z is the length of one side, and distance between x, y and distance is are the other two sides. So what we should expect is that this should be less than or equal to that. Okay, this should be less than or equal to that. Okay, so this is true for every x, y, z in X. Okay. And because of the comments which I made just now, this last property is called triangle inequality. Okay, this last property is called triangle inequality. Okay, this is called triangle inequality. Okay. By the way, similarly, in this definition of a norm, this property 2 is also called triangle inequality. Okay, this is also called triangle inequality. And we'll see the reason for this little later. Okay. All right. So that is about a metric. Okay. And so what is a metric space? Again, in a similar way, metric space is a pair XD where X is a non-empty set and D is a metric defined on it. Okay. So let us just record it once again. So. Okay. Metric space. Is a pair XD where X is a non-empty set. Okay, here also I should have said is called a metric on X. This is called a metric on X. Okay. So coming back to this, a metric space is a pair XD where X is a non-empty set. And D is a metric on X. Okay. And again, why pair again? Because when one can define several metrics on the same set X. So, for example, I can define say D1 as one metric, D2 as the another, D3 as another. So, the set underlying set may be the same, but the metrics may be different. So, in which case those become different metric spaces. Okay. Now, you can see that all these axioms which we have written here are the properties which you associate with the usual concept of distance. Okay. And those are the ones which are taken for defining the distance. Now, you may ask, there are some many other things also which we associate with a distance. Okay. For example, we also know that given two points, we can talk of something like a midpoint of the two, and then that has not come here in the axioms. But again, which of the properties to be chosen for making definition, that is a matter of convenience and also a matter of history, because this definition like this arise after several years of efforts from various mathematicians by trying various axioms and which work better, etc. And ultimately it is decided which exactly the things that go into the definition. Okay. So let us not go into that kind of history right now. Let us see some examples of the metric spaces. So, in example means what? It should be some non-empty set and a function defined like this. And usually, given a function like this, to check whether it forms a metric or not, usually these two properties are very easy to check. In fact, quite trivial. Okay. And if at all anything takes some time, it is this last property. Okay. It is this last property, triangle inequality. Okay. There is one very famous example. This is a metric which you can define on any set. Okay. Suppose X is any non-empty set, and suppose you define say dxy is equal to 0 if X equal to Y and 1 if X not equal to Y. Okay. Okay. It is easy to see that it satisfies all these properties. Okay. Only this last property will take some time to check. Okay. As I said, okay. Other two properties are trivial. Okay. So this is also a well-known metric. It is called a discrete metric, and this space is called a discrete metric space. Okay. It is called discrete metric space. And the main use of this discrete metric space is basically for understanding. Okay. It is not much of practical importance. You don't come across discrete metric in any applications, but in order to understand the various concepts in metric spaces and to check whether you have understood or not, this example is very useful. Okay. All right. Then the next obvious example is that of a real line. Okay. You can take the real line and define dxy as mod x minus y. Okay. distance between x, that is the usual distance between the two real numbers, okay. And again it is easy to see that that satisfies all these three properties, okay. Okay, and now let us come back to this, okay. Let us come back to this, we will just finish this. So what we have seen, that this function norm is nothing but the generalization of the function of the absolute value, okay. So we can use this idea in any norm linear space, okay. Suppose I take, instead of taking x and y as two real numbers, suppose I take x and y as two elements in a vector space and define distance between x and y as norm of x minus y, okay. Then that should also satisfy all these properties, because those are basically followed from the properties of the absolute value. Let us just quickly see how this happens and then we will stop with that, okay. So now suppose let us say V is a norm linear space, and take any two x and y in V and define dxy as norm of x minus y, okay, right. Then we will just quickly verify these properties one by one, okay. What is the first thing that we require? The distance between x and y should be bigger than or equal to 0, okay, right. Is it true? Norm of, okay, and this should be 0 if and only if x equal to y, is, does that also true? That follows from this pattern, norm of x minus y will be 0 if and only if x minus y, which is same as x equal to y, okay, alright. What about this distance between x, y is equal to distance between y, x? So distance between y, x will be norm y minus x, right, by this definition, okay. Are these two things same? By what it follows from what? It is nothing but minus 1 times this, okay, and that follows from this last property. If you take alpha is equal to minus, that is basically norm of minus x is same as norm of x for every x, okay. So this symmetry follows from this property 3, okay, right. What about the triangular inequality? This is norm of x minus z, okay, this is norm of x minus y, and that is norm of y minus z, okay. Is that true that norm of x minus z is less than or equal to norm of x minus y plus norm of y minus z? Again, you see, you can, for example, suppose you take a as x minus z, b as x minus y, and c as y minus z, then you can say that norm of a plus b is less than or equal to norm a plus norm b, and it will give this, okay. So this property 2 implies this triangular inequality here, and that is why that is also called triangular inequality, okay. So what follows from it is that every norm linear space can be made into a metric space, okay. Every norm will lead to a metric on that vector space, okay. And so this is a big class of examples of metric spaces, and that is what is most important in applications, okay. Most metric spaces which are important from the point of view of applications are basically norm linear spaces. I think we'll stop with that. We shall see more examples of this in the next class.